In the previous tutorial, I demonstrated and showed some of the features and concepts of Microsoft databases, as well as created a table and defined the specific fields within a table. What we're going to do is add and import information from other sources out there. For example, suppose this is our table with customers. One of the options is, of course, to type the data in here or in some kind of form that we'll demonstrate in a little bit here. However, the question is, how can you bring in data from another source, such as Microsoft Access or a text, comma, separated file, comma, separated values file from another source? So in this case, we have the table already defined with all the different fields, like we discussed earlier. And if we go under View, Design View, we can see all the different fields, all the different types of data. So now, as long as we have a file that contains the same order of the fields here and the same data type, then we can bring that data into Microsoft Access very easily from another system such as Microsoft Excel. Open our table here, Customers table. Then we click on External Data. We're going to get this data from some other source. Then we click on Microsoft Excel, and then we go to where we have the data. So in this case, I have it under Dropbox. And then we go to Microsoft Access. And let's say we want to bring in the customer list. In this case, we have three choices that we can make: import the data into a new table or append it to the records in an existing table. So in this case, we defined all the components or all the fields of this table. So now we just want to add the data. Then we click OK. And then we click on, this is what the table looks, or the data looks from Excel. So we have customer ID, the company, first name, last name, telephone number, and so on. So then we click on Next. Then we click on Next again. And then we're going to import it to the table Customers. We click on Finish. And then we could save these steps if we ever wanted to bring data in the future as well. But for now, we do not have to. Click on Close, and then notice that our Customers table has been populated with data that we had in Microsoft Access. Since we are in this view, notice that we could sort this data in any way we want. Notice the tools here on Sort and Filter. We could add new ones, we could create, find different records, and so on. However, this is not really the way to use the database. We are just in the initial stages of defining and designing the database, but you could sort it in any way you'd prefer. For example, ascending here, now we have all the customers in ascending order. So this is one of the ways to bring in the data from another program. So we had the table designed, and then we are bringing all that data back in. Another way to bring in the data is by basically having an Excel file or some kind of comma-separated values file into another program, and then we import that data into Access by creating a completely new table. So we click here under External Data, then we go under Access, and then we go and browse, and let's say we have the contact list. So we want a list of all the contracts that we kept record of them into Access, and then we click OK. In this case, notice that this is the sample data. We have the contract number, customer ID, amount, date, and so on. Then we click on Next. We are telling Microsoft Access the first row here in Excel has the names of the fields. And then we click on Next. Then we can specify each type of data for each field. So we could go and say, okay, this field is going to be currency, for example, or this is going to be a date format, and we could change this accordingly the way we want to. And then we'll get into the primary keys and foreign keys in a moment. However, each table, just for the sake of just mentioning it at this point, each table needs a primary key. So since we are dealing with contracts and there is a field with contract number, then probably we should give it the name, or we should use the existing field that was in the data from Excel as a primary key. The primary key base is basically one of the fields that makes each one of the records here. The records like number 1, 2, 3, like the whole row, what makes it different from one another. So then we click on next. So we're going to make the contract number the primary key. Then we click on next. And then we're going to name this table the contracts. And then we click on finish. Close. And notice now we have two tables. Notice. Contract number, customer ID, amount, date, and so on. If we wanted at this point to change the design of the contacts table, we could click on view, go under design view, and change specific pieces of data here. So for example, the number, we don't have to have it 255 characters, we could have it only a 4-digit number. Or let's make it a 6-digit number. The customer ID doesn't have to be 255 characters. We could have it a 6-digit number. The contract number, date, and the type, we could change it the way we want. Once we are done with it, make sure that you close each table and saving the changes. And basically, we are done with that part of it. A third way is to import data from a comma-separated values file. And this basically, what that means is it's data that has been exported from a corporate system or some kind of system out there, and it has been exported into a CSV, what's called CSV format. And basically it looks just like a basic text file. You have each field in quotes here separated by a comma. So that's how the computer knows that each record, actually each field, is separated by a comma. So we're going to bring this data into another table in Microsoft Access. So let's say we're going to have keep track of the customers, keep track of the contracts, and then we're going to keep track of the invoices. So we'll click on external data, and then we're going to import from a text file. So this could be a delimited or fixed width text file. We click on browse, we go under invoice list, and then we're going to create a new table. Notice this is a delimited, so comma delimited. Then we click on next. CSV, C stands for comma there on the name of the file. However, it could be a tab delimited, or it could be semicolon or some other format. And then we're going to say that the first row here contains the field's names, the field names. So we click on that. Then we click on next. And then we specify the type of data for each field. Then we choose the primary key. Since the invoice number or the invoice table has already numbers assigned to it, then we can choose that as a primary key. The main thing is that the key should not have, or the primary key cannot have duplicate numbers in there. And usually the way it works is that you create the tables manually and then you import the data like we did for the customers table. But this is just as an example of how to show and how to bring or import a CSV file into Microsoft Access. So then you click on Next, and then we're going to name this table Invoices, and then we click on Finish. So if we double click on Invoices, notice we have the invoice number, contract number, invoice date, and additional information as well. Now notice that the invoice paid, yes or no. We want to make this, instead of saying yes or no, we want to make it so that it has a check mark for it. So you can go under Design View, and then Invoice Paid, we can change the data type to yes or no. We could change the number, like we for specifying the field length to, let's say, 6. The date is fine, the item, it's kind of too long, the amount, we leave it alone, and then we are done with the design of this table. We could add additional fields if we wanted. Now is the time to add those additional fields. Then we click on yes and click on yes again. That message just came up. It's basically saying that you need to be careful when you resize the fields because you could lose information. You could actually lose data. So at this point, we have three tables. Let's say this is what we are keeping track of in our company. We have contracts, we have customers, and then we have invoices for each contact and each customer. So then the next component here is how do we link those tables? And this is what makes us call them relational databases. Basically, the tables within those databases, or within a database, are linked together through the use of the primary keys and the foreign keys. So notice here under the customers, if we have customer ID as one of the fields. And if we go under design here, we note that there is this golden key next to it. That means it's the primary key. That's what differentiates things in that table, or what makes the records unique for that table. If we go to invoices, or actually let's go to contracts first, notice we have the contract number, which is the primary key. However, there is also a customer ID field, which will change the customer ID type to a number in this case, because that customer ID is going to be linked to the customer ID from the contacts table is going to be linked to the customers table through the same common field in there, which is customer ID. So the key here is that the data type, notice here it's an auto number or a number under the customers table, and if we want to link it with the contacts table, then that has to be, the data type has to be a number as well, or the same type of data. So this is very important, otherwise you'll not be able to link those tables together. Now if we go to the invoices table and go into design view, note here as well, so that we have the invoice number, and let's change it to a number, and the contract number. If you remember from contracts, we have contract number. In this case, it's text. However, we could change that to a number, because that's what would be more realistically. And then invoices, the invoice contract number under the invoices needs to be changed. The data type needs to be changed to a number as well, so it matches with that field. Now, notice in this case, the invoice number here is the primary key for this table. However, the contact number can be what's called a foreign key for another table. So, for example, the contracts, in the contacts table, contact number is a primary key, which is going to link to the contact number, the foreign key, in the invoices table. It's kind of a difficult concept. However, just remember, they need to match the data type, and you need to have a common field between these tables in order to link them together. So once we have made the changes and adjustments here in the design, we click on save. It's going to come up with that some data might be lost or a warning here. Be very careful with this. Same thing on the next table. And same thing on the next table as well. So at this point, if we look at them, it still have the same data. Now, at this point, we are going to actually define the relationship. So we're going to click under Database Tools, and this is how you specify the relationship. Click on Relationships, and then put all the tables in. So add all the tables here. So we basically have the customers, then we have contracts, then we have invoices, kind of a logical way here. Now note here, I'm going to move those a little bit farther apart here. So you have customer ID and customer ID. So this is the primary key for the customers table, and then we drag the customer ID to the foreign key under the contracts table. Notice the relationship type here, it's going to be a one-to-many, meaning we have one customer that has multiple contracts. And that's what you want, is that you want one customer with multiple requests for you to do work for them. You could click on Enforce Referential Integrity, and this will explain it some other time, but basically, if you delete a customer, then it's going to delete their contracts as well. Or if you delete a student or a student withdraws from school, then it would also unenroll the student from all the classes that they have been enrolled into. So it's basically to just, and that would be under the cascade up records, cascade update, cascade delete. So all these different options would be available by enabling the referential integrity. In our case here, we're going to keep it simple. And this is where you change the type of the relationship if we need it to. So here we click on create, and that has been defined. The next thing here is that we have contracts, the contract number here, and then we have contract number as a foreign key in the invoices table. So in this case, again, this would be the common field, so we drag the contact number to the contact number in the other table. That's a one-to-many relationship as well. So that means that you have one contract, but you could have different multiple invoices related to that contract. So then we click on Create. So at this point, we have defined the relationship between these two multiple tables, and that what that does basically is that we can then create a report, we can create a query where we could have first name, the last name of the customer, we could specify the contract amount, the contract type, and then even we could specify the amount for specific invoices in those contracts. So what we are doing here is we are pulling data from all three tables. So basically, this is it for this part of the tutorial. What we just did here is that we defined three tables. We got data from other systems, and then once we defined the structure of each table and we imported the data into them, then we created and defined the relationship through the primary keys and the foreign keys between the different tables. Now, usually in an actual business database, you'd have hundreds of these tables and the tables linked in multiple ways between one another. So in this case, before you go any further, you need to save the relationship definitions here, and we are good to go. As far as creating queries, that's what's going to be next, so check out the next tutorial. And so we're going to go into queries next, and then we are going to go into forms, and we're going to go into reports as well in another couple tutorials here.